everyone. Welcome to another episode of Magic TV. This time, instead of Tristan Sean Gregson, we've got Josh Utter-Leyton. I guess they have the same number of words in their name, so.
I'm an acceptable replacement then.
Yeah, especially considering you are the U.S. national champion.
I am.
So, which is pretty awesome. How does that feel?
Pretty awesome.
Yeah, I mean, you had a pretty good top eight there, and you didn't actually have to battle anyone from Channel Fireball, although it came close.
Yeah. It's kind of unfortunate. It's like what PV says, where you always feel however you did in your last round. Like, even if you know you're 7-1 in the GP, you feel awesome if you won your last round to get there.
Right.
But if you lost your last round, you know, you feel like shit because you just lost your last round.
Yeah.
Well, I feel kind of the same way in that I won the tournament, but I kind of lost my last round. That's kind of how I feel.
Because Webb lost the playoffs.
Right.
Yeah. I was talking at Nationals with some people and how I think the third, fourth playoff has to be one of the highest tension matches at Nationals. It has to be one of the highest tension matches that can exist in Pro Magic. Like,
I don't know how it compares to like a Pro Tour finals. You know, well, there's a lot more at stake there.
Well, right, money wise there is, but
not just money, but like legacy. You know, yeah. People care about top eights. They care about wins. They don't care about, you know, finals versus.
Right, but when you talk about Nationals, the third, fourth playoff is the one that the most people care about.
Okay, sure.
So not even on a personal level, but like. It determines the national team, who represents the country, which is a big deal to a lot of people.
And yeah, definitely.
And also, whenever you've got a third, fourth playoff, the other two people who are in the finals are bound to be rooting for one of the two people. Mm-hmm. And in this case, you know, we are obviously all rooting for David Ochoa, and, you know, he kind of dropped the ball on that. I say that mostly because he's actually sitting right off camera writing his Nationals report for the website. But anyway, I mean, yeah, like, the third, fourth playoff's a big deal. Like, I actually played it in my first Nationals. I lost to Paul Chien in the top four. Uh-huh. Then I had to play against Ben Zaz in the third, fourth playoff. And I knew Paul was on the team. You know, we were living together. He's like one of my best friends. And I knew Ben Lundquist was on the team. He's the other guy in the finals who's, you know, I really like. Also, I scooped him in the top eight. A good friend of mine. He's awesome. And so I'm sitting here playing. And if I win, I'm on the team with those two awesome guys. And if I lose, just I'm not.
Yeah.
It was, I mean, Paul later said that watching that 3-4 playoff felt to him more important than winning the finals. And Ben said the same thing. It was easier for Paul because Paul won the finals.
Yeah, I mean, I would certainly have taken second in the tournament to have Webb on the team.
Yeah, that's how crazy the third, fourth playoff can be. Like, mm-hmm. it's just a big match. I mean, it determines a lot of, like, you know, the national team. And the national team is a unique experience. I mean, again, I played on two national teams. We didn't do well either time, but just being on the team was awesome. I can't imagine what it would be like to win. So hopefully you'll find that out. I mean, you've got you, Anthony Eason, who's, I've been told, the current Pokemon World Champion. And who also, you know, he did well in the tournament. He started 7-0. I don't know how he did day two, but, you know, he piloted Mono Red, you know, to the finals of the tournament.
Yeah.
He may have gotten a little unlucky against you in one of the games.
Yeah, that last game was pretty absurd, you know. Needed him to, you know, draw land straight for five turns, and he did. So,
well,
that's pretty sweet.
He could have drawn... I'm trying to think of a spell he could have drawn.
He could have drawn the ricochet traps he said were in. Okay. I think he did. I think he did draw one.
Yeah, so, I think, you know, he might have drawn one of the ricochet traps, which was probably a misstep, I would say.
Yeah.
I mean, they're kind of a trap. and then you have got Conrad Kolos playing Mono Green Eldrazi, who beat Webb in the playoffs. So,
right.
I mean, not the national team you were hoping to see. And I think, especially considering Brad Nelson was in the top eight, unfortunately he lost to Webb. The pairings made it so only one of them could possibly be on the team. And then you had to beat Gerard Fabiano to make it past, which another person a lot of people were rooting for.
Yeah.
You know, who's always a fan favorite.
Yeah, the brackets, you know, were different. Certainly could have had a very different team.
Yeah, yeah. And Ifro, Eric Frolik, was also, you know, he also lost in the first round. So you had a number of the people, you know, we were rooting for lost. But, I mean, you've got your team now. You got to work with that. And it still seems like it's going to be a fine team. Like, you've...
Yeah, definitely agree. I think,
yeah.
You know... People haven't been too happy with the team, but I think, you know, hopefully we'll surprise some people.
I mean, people thought the team I was on was awesome. Me, Ben Lundquist, and Paul Chien, and we went 1-3. So it's not going to be short for you to beat that. The other thing about the way Nationals works now, or the team competition, is now you've got three man, but you play a different constructed format, which is a lot less on teamwork than the two that I played. I played Team Roch. Like Team Rochester, where, you know, they open the pack, lay it all out face up, and
yeah.
You go around and pick, you know. which is one of the most skill-intensive formats, you know, imaginable. And one of the reasons we didn't do well is that all three of us were relatively new to the pro scene. None of us had ever played a Team Roch event. And then I played Twitter Giant, which I'm not going to go into too much, but Twitter Giant is just not a good format. Whereas then the year after that, you know, it was the three-man team trios constructed, which Paul, Mike Jacob, and Sam Black, you know, crushed. So Actually, David Ochoa appears in the credits of the national team victory there. He provided Paul's legacy deck list that Paul went undefeated with, which carried the team to victory. So even though he's wasn't on the team that year either, he is there in spirit. So you guys have to play, presumably, legacy extended standard. They haven't, I don't think, officially announced it. But, okay. I mean, I don't know if you know.
I do not.
Special national winning briefing that you get. But who do you expect to play each format?
I'm playing Legacy.
You're shotgunning it?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, as the winner of Nationals is usually kind of like the de facto leader, just because, you know, you won the tournament. That's kind of how it falls into place. It's not always like that, but I mean, I think no one's going to oppose you if you gun Legacy. And then you leave it to the other two guys to figure out whichever format they're most comfortable with. In terms of Magic tournament experience, it usually goes like the least experienced person plays Standard, then Extended, and Legacy. Mm-hmm. I know how like PV last year, when it was him, Carlos Ramau, and their third, who hadn't played as much, but you know, their third played Standard, Carlos plays Extended, Paulo played Legacy. So under that rating, or under that system, Conrad would probably be the one playing Extended, and then you leave it to Tony Eason to play Standard. Because as far as we both know, I think this was one of Tony's first big tournaments, if not his first.
Yes.
Yes, that's Raptor for you. we were, before the show, we were actually wondering who had more words lifetime, and we weren't actually wondering who had more words, we were just stating that I had more words. Both in...
Well, see, you have a few years on me, so...
It's true.
That's why you're beating me.
I think if you account for that, I think I'm still probably ahead.
I think you had me beat, you know, when you were like 12.
Yeah, both in volume and quantity. Like volume, like, you know, noise volume.
We should ask Butler, you know, what level he had to adjust mine up to, so that everybody hearing this now is hearing the same volume.
Well, if you guys weren't aware, your mic's on actually twice as loud.
Yeah.
But, yeah, so you've got teams. So go over to the deck you played in Standard.
So I played Mythic. Pretty basic list, except there's no non-mana creatures, basically. Most Mythic lists will play, you know, Baneslayers or Warmonks or Dauntless Escorts, and I didn't want to play any of those.
Warmonk being the classic poster child for terrible cards that Mythic plays. Like, Warmonk is the most reviled card, I think, among our circle of players.
Well, I've certainly been on a war against Warmonk across all formats, you know. It was originally in the list we started with for Legacy.
Yeah, that's true.
And, you know, I just absolutely refuse. There's just no way I'm going to play this card in Legacy.
Warmonk's just the epitome of a dirtle creature. It looks like it does something, but it doesn't. Like, it against control, like, I mean, I was talking about it in one of my articles where you hit the control with Warmonk three times and then you lose because it doesn't do anything.
Right.
And against aggro, like, well, you should be able to build your deck to beat aggro without having to rely on Warmonk. So you cut all the chafe, basically, and you just narrowed it down to a core of mana creatures, sovereigns, which you played four of, the two Eldrazi conscriptions, and then a bunch of planeswalkers. You played a little more than normal, although most Mythic lists run about five or six. You played seven.
Yeah. Mythic's been playing a lot of planeswalkers. You know, Tom Rainey kind of popularized the planeswalker-heavy Mythic list, and he was playing nine planeswalkers before. Yeah. He started the trend to you know, cut all these creatures. And then with M11... Mana Leak came about, and suddenly you were able to cut the Warmonks for Mana Leaks, and then you're not what Mythic used to be, like this creature mid-range creature attack deck. It had all these, you know, dudes that you were tagged with trying to get some damage in, but it was kind of slow on that front. And then, you know, the Sovereigns and Conscription came along and just kind of gave the deck this new angle. Then M11 with Mana Leak. And it's no longer a creature attack deck. Now it's just, you know, a straight-up ramp deck. You're ramping into planeswalkers. You're ramping into the, you know, this hasty...
It actually reminds me kind of aggro control, where you've got a reasonable clock and you've got disruption. Like, it's not like a clock as in, like, incremental damage. It's more a clock like race to casting one of your big spells, which immediately kills them, plus disruption.
I never looked at the deck like that. I actually came to the deck and started liking the deck once I looked at it as, you know, a better turbo land deck.
Yeah.
Basically, all of your ramp spells are just a mana cheaper than, you know, Rampant Growth or Explore.
Right, and you don't go off as flashy, but you still attack them for 12 or 13, and then next turn have two, you know, 10.
Yeah, you're not, like, Avenger into Time Warp into kill them, but you're still, your Avenger of Zendikar costs 6 mana and still gets them just as dead. And your Planeswalkers, are just as absurd as, Jason in a Turboland deck.
Yeah, and I think you could probably point to the most commented on card in your deck list.
Explore, certainly.
Right.
There's no way getting around it's the worst card in the deck, but...
Well, then why don't you cut it?
You can't play more than 4 of any of the cards in the deck,
Well, you're only playing 3 Elspeths.
That's true.
Yeah, okay. Well, before I make too much fun of you, the reason behind Explore is you wanted more mana accelerators. Llanowar Elves, just not a good fit. And Explore, in particular, gets around one of the vulnerabilities that people attack Mythic, which is killing your mana guys to delay your big drops. Explore you're only playing 2, but it still goes a little towards being able to play like a turn 3 Elspeth against a Jund deck.
Right.